First item will be approval of the meeting summary. Last meeting.
I move.
Second.
Okay. I'm sorry, Tom, I have my hand up and got it up before there was a motion made.
Okay, go ahead. Go ahead. We do have a motion and a second, but go ahead, Ed.
I did have my hand up before the motion and the second happened, though, so I don't know how I'm supposed to do this in a proper order.
Go ahead.
Okay. So the minutes have more detail than they usually do, but they're still missing quite a bit. And since I take my own notes, I'd like to offer some corrections and additions into the minutes. So specifically, I want to note that the conversations that were captured in the notes this time do a pretty good job of capturing what was said by non-CAC members. But when it comes to the CAC members, there was only one comment that was captured by Melvin Cohen, whereas there was pretty robust participation by a number of other CAC members, and they are our meetings. So I do think that our conversations should be captured in there. So if you don't mind, I'd like to read some of the stuff that's missing. And I do my own timestamps. They're not based on the video time. They're based on the time of day. Is that okay, Tom?
So what we're trying to limit our corrections or our changes here to actual changes or corrections in the presented summary. Rather than adding on to the summary, which would, change the summary, we're asked to make any changes that are substantive changes that represent an error or omission.
And my point is that there are many omissions, and I think that what is left out is substantive, and the choice to leave it out or the accident to leave it out does change the reflection of what happened at the last meeting. And I have offered in the past to email my notes around and have not been taken up on that. But as we discussed last time, inadequate meeting minutes make it difficult for committee members and members of the public to ascertain what happened at the previous meeting, and it's not reasonable to ask people to go back and watch a 2-hour or 3-hour meeting. The fact that we now have slightly more detailed minutes, but they still leave out pretty substantial parts of the conversation, is of concern to me. If I'm allowed to read corrections and additions in, I will. If not, I would like a proposal for how to best fill in the holes in the meeting summaries.
Okay. Let's not do that now, but we need to find a way where your notes can be shared with the rest of the committee. You're asking about that now. Farhad, can you help me with that?
Yes, again, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, as a reminder, and it's actually on the agenda on your slides, meeting summaries are only intended to capture official actions of the committee, where there is a motion and a second and a vote. Other than that, there is the recording, there's the video, there's the legal action reports. By law, the video, the recording are the minutes of the meeting. The summary is not intended to be minutes. It's simply capturing actions of the committee.
So how can we circulate Abby's notes for instance?
Post meeting, if you like, that's fine. We can include that in the minutes of the next meeting as something that was offered during the meeting. But again, it's unofficial and it could be captured in the next meeting's packet.
And I would ask again that we do get official, better summaries. I hear what you're saying, Farhad, about our minimal legal requirements. But the point of this committee is to do public outreach and telling the public that they can go back and watch 3-hour meetings as opposed to being able to provide notes, which the notes from last meeting clearly indicate that somebody is able to and willing to take good notes, they're just missing entire parts of our conversation. And I do believe that that is something that we can fix. That's why I've brought this up at every single meeting. I'd like a solution. I don't want to be the official note taker, but for me as an active member of the committee, I need my notes to know what happened last time. I cannot imagine that we would think that it's okay to ask a member of the public to work with less. So Tom, I guess I'm asking for direction from you and I'm going to mute myself.
Yeah, forward those comments, if you will, and I'll arrange to get those disseminated at the appropriate time. And we'll continue to try to get as complete a summary of the actions as we can. Again, there's that limitation that Farhad just explained. And I know it's frustrating. We'll continue to try to beef it up as best we can. All right, any other comments about the motion and second? Motion was by Ron, second by Arlen. Yeah. All right, hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no.
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 All right, heard four no's and any abstentions?
I wasn't here.
I just heard mine because I was overlapping with somebody else, but maybe we should count off.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Chair, I wasn't here either, so I abstain.
All right, so both Bruce and Ramon are abstaining. Could I have the no's say again and just give the next number? So the first one say one, the next one say two.
One,
two,
oh,
three,
four.
Five.
Five.
Nope, that would make a six.
Oh, seven then.
Can you have them just call out their names?
Yeah. All right. Ava.
No, just individually.
Yeah. My name, Ava. No, you can go ahead and put me down for a no.
Yes. Okay. Abby.
No.
Debbie?
No.
Diane?
No.
Chris? Chris Schmaltz?
I'm a yes on the motion.
Okay. And Edmund?
Aye.
Jamie?
Aye.
Amy says aye. Karen?
Abstain.
Okay. Moss?
No.
It kills.
Mary?
That me, Mary?
Yes.
Aye.
All right. Patricia?
No.
Okay.
Six no's.
Six no's, one, two abstentions, three abstentions, sorry. All right.
How many ayes is that then?
Seven. Motion passes. All right. Next item is any submitted public comments for the meeting?
We do not have any, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Main item for our meeting, and that's continued discussion on the sales tax plan. Last time we got quite a bit of conversation about the transit element. Since then, I asked if Carolyn could help decipher the proposal that had been prepared before and try to frame it in terms that we've been using all along as far as the sub elements, so we could compare kind of side by side and to make sure that everyone on the committee understands. We know there are questions about exactly what that means. And after last time, we talked about the COA and kind of what the impacts of current funding have. It may give us some ideas about where funding should be directed. And as a result, using the same technology, same wording as it is being used, in the same breakdown of sub-elements as has been used all along and is used in the long-range transit plan to be helpful. Additionally, and before I turn it over to Carolyn to give us some of that information. I've talked to you before about the need for us to prioritize the projects, the named projects, because once the final cost estimates come in and once we finalize the transit element, particularly, there's going to be inadequate funds most likely for the remainder or for all of the 33 projects to be funded. And we need to develop a methodology for deciding which projects we will be able to fund or will recommend to the board be funded. So what I've talked to Jeanette about this, and she's going to be in touch with the RTA's tech staff to go back to the ranking exercise that we did earlier in the year, I guess, or the year ago. And the only thing I would ask for, and we'll provide that to the committee as soon as the IT staff is able to put it together for us. But I would really like to get everybody to participate in that exercise. It's really important that we hear as a group what our kind of joint priorities are. And that will at least, if we can get everyone to participate in this ranking process, it'll give us an idea where as a committee we stand and be a starting point at least for us to discuss, you know, what are the projects that it looks like we're not gonna be able to fund given things that I just mentioned. So does anybody have a comment about that, about my desire to do that? Bruce?
Mr. Chairman, I support and understand what you're trying to do. I guess I have a question. My understanding is, in listening to previous comments by Farhad, that the dynamics of how projects come forward depends on where a particular jurisdiction is and the readiness of that project, and it may not be happening sequentially. That in fact, one community may be ready to move forward with their project in their first 5 or 10 years of the process, and some may not come later. So, even if we rank them like 1 through 35 and prioritize them, that doesn't necessarily mean that they are going to come up in that order. And so I wanted that, have that understanding. And then secondly, my comment would be back to the policy considerations, which we put on the table pending these discussions. It is this whole issue of what if, in fact, as I believe it will, revenues exceed projections. And let's just say best case that we could move beyond the 35. This committee has done nothing to prioritize subsequent projects that were high on the list for consideration and that eventuality. Now, I understand the assertions made, well, the board will have the discretion to do that. projects, but I think it'd be worth our while to revisit those projects as well, to look at whether some of those still higher high medium projects might want to be put into a list. So that's just my
comment. Let me make sure I understand. You're talking about projects, let's just say, ranked 34 through 108.
So I doubt it would go that far.
Well, I know I understand that, but we're talking about trying to look at that, those other 70 some projects to decide if we want to recommend others as a, what do we call, a reserve group. Okay.
And I would suspect that would probably only take us down through the medium rank projects, not the low rank projects, but I have no magic insight into that. It just seems to me that that would give expression to what those priorities are and guidance to, you know, projects that could come forward if there were additional revenues.
Okay. I think we're going to have to hold that until we can get through our basic task here, but we will bring that back for conversation once we do that. Just as once we can get these projects ranked, we can get through the transit and the other sub-element discussions to settle on what the amounts, the other elements. Once we can settle on what's the amount of money in each of the buckets that we're recommending, at that point, we want to get back into and complete the discussion about those policies and suggestions or recommendations to the board.
Could Farhad comment though on this notion about the dynamics of how projects present themselves?
Sure, I'll be happy to. As you all recall, the next phase in this process was to have sponsoring entities to finalize their scope cost estimate, and then as part of that exercise, if you recall, even in the current plan, they're broken up in four different periods. So that question goes back to what you were saying. So as part of this finalizing the scope and the cost, that question will be also answered, which period over the next 20 years you believe you will have the project ready for construction. And then that shuffling of the projects will happen at that point. For example, you got projects 1 through 30, most likely 25% of them first quarter, 25% second quarter, third and fourth. So they may still be a higher priority project, but they're not ready until the fourth quarter. And that'll be shown on the ballot as well.
That was my question, is whether those different proposed allocations or schedules would show up on the ballot.
Yes.
So that does.
Yes.
Thank you.
I recall they are put in 5-year.
There are four periods, period 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5 years each.
I guess we have period 0, which is the four projects that have been.
That'll be period 1 as well, because it has to be tied to the plan.
All right. All right, Carolyn, you want to talk about your.
Sure.
Or I'm sorry, were there any other comments about the idea of ranking these projects? Dale, and then Moss, I don't know if you're just getting ready to help Carolyn with this or not, but hang on a second.
My comment is, I just wanted to reiterate what you said about really encouraging people to do this, ranking the next of things. All need to sit down and do it. If you're not, don't do that ranking, you're definitely fighting on the boat. And I really want to emphasize to everybody that if we're here, we've got to really get everybody to get.
I'm sorry, but it's really hard to understand what Dale's saying. Dale, can you either repeat that, or Tom, can you summarize that?
Yeah, maybe a little closer to the microphone.
Yeah. Bottom line is, I'm just trying to encourage everybody to participate. Doing this, to participate in computer ranking. you know, the computer rank really amounts to a vote. And if you're really serious about what those projects need to be and how they need to be ranked, everybody needs to
really participate in doing that computer ranking. And that's the sum total.
Very good. Thanks. And
I follow up too on that.
Yeah, go ahead.
I agree, Dale. And I would just encourage, last couple times we've been sent these requests, we haven't had very much time. It's usually just a couple day turnaround. So hopefully, if we request that and we have a month, we can have a little more time to do it. That's just a hopeful request. Because I know we're in every couple weeks. So that's all.
Okay. Debbie, I saw your hand up. Hang on just a second. Boss, did you want to weigh in on this one or are you waiting?
Yeah, I was just, I just wanted to check in because I heard at the last Mayor and Council study session, Tucson Mayor and Council study session, that there was a plan that staff were putting forward about kind of rethinking how there were, trying to, I think it sounded like I heard a lot of our feedback about how the process has been pretty linear rather than really looking at the needs of our community and transportation system holistically. And so it's been a couple of weeks, but as I roughly recall, they were going to kind of really look back since it's been, I think 4 years now since a lot of this came through, and we're going to try to kind of think about how name projects go into different categories and try to just kind of think holistically about how that happens. So I was just kind of wanting to raise that is a discussion that's happening, and also just see how we were planning to, it sounds like a really reasonable and smart approach that they're undertaking. So I was just trying to see how that might fit in and how we want to, plan our process given that, in that direction.
Thanks for mentioning that. I've also heard from the city more or less what the way that they're trying to look at their projects, at least in a holistic manner, as they put it. That will be information that ultimately is presented to the TMC, I think, in an effort, at least the city has said, a couple reps have said to me that they would like for the other jurisdictions to kind of look at the overall plan the way that they are to make sure that it all comes together in a way that makes sense. And I'm sure that they'll also present something to us once they've gotten to that point. I have not heard what their schedule for that is. And in the meantime, I don't think it changes, our need to proceed as we are. Should there be a major change of sorts, obviously, that's still up in the air, I'm sure, and whether the board wants to make any change in kind of the way that they want to structure the plan, those are all future discussions, but appreciate you bringing that up. Debbie, did I see you waving your hand online?
No, I don't know why that's saying that. I said I didn't push Ray's hand, so sorry.
Oh, no problem.
I'm going to move the mic.
This is just real deal, Lex, right? And it's personal because I missed most of the last ranking because I was away. We have an estimate of how much time we'll have and when are we talking? September, October, November to do this, or can we get that? And again, I'm going to be away for part of this time, and I want to be able to participate. For Dale.
Thank you.
I take orders from Dale. So thank you.
Yeah, I think a lot of it has to do with our process here moving forward, but I would hope to at least get a couple of weeks available for people to to dig into this. It probably is not going to be a month long, availability, because they do want it to become the starting point for our discussions as a group. While it's important that everyone participates so that we have an accurate view of what the average ranking might be, there's still quite a bit of conversation that we'll need to have around such things as did the way that we rank all these projects create an imbalance in unweighting, if you will, as to types of projects, or when that is, whose jurisdiction may have ended up at the bottom or the top, and those sorts of conversations about balancing the geography and the coverage. But my intention is for us to have a couple of weeks to do that. Yeah.
So are you suggesting we use the same metrics that we did before, or come up with the metrics? I was saying if we're using the same ones, we can get started now. You want to refine that somewhat, or put a hold in that?
Yeah, the ranking, make sure I use the terminology correctly. The ranking is where we essentially had several different categories that either automatically got points depending on where they fell as far as the safety ranking, safety rating, as an example, pedestrian safety rating, and then had a few that we were able to input our own opinion into. But we also have simply the priority ranking, which was just without the score, was simply which project was most important to us and which was least. And because at the time we did this originally, there was over 100 projects. Now we're really just dealing with the 33. And that's, I think, the difference at this point. You'll still have the information available to you about that ranking exercise that we did. I would also caution you that we didn't have, to Dale's request, we did not have a tremendous participation rate in that, both because we didn't have probably enough time to devote to it, and whatever other things were going on at the time. Got it, Bruce.
Following up on Moss's comment, if in fact the city of Tucson is reexamining how they're approaching the projects and urging the other jurisdictions to do that, it would seem to me that it would make the process more rational if we could ask that the jurisdictions and the TMC go through that process first and bring their recommendations to us. Otherwise, we're going to have this disconnect again between TMC and CAC. And I would like to be informed by the TMC and the jurisdictions about their approach, since they're the professionals. So it would be helpful. And again, it also reinforces Carolyn's notion, is that we need time to factor all that in and be able to go through the exercise. So.
Yeah, and frankly, from what I know of this ongoing exercise, it isn't something that we as a committee really are able to do. This is something that the individual jurisdictions and their professional staffs and electeds perhaps would have to be involved in. So that appropriately would go to the TMC before we would be taking any kind of action. And I would suggest it would most likely be going to the board as well before it came back to us. Still, we'll learn more about it as time goes on. If the city, to go forward with that process, as I think they are. Okay, let's now move into a continuation of our transit element discussion from last time. I know also that there were some follow-up, some questions that we had some promised follow-ups from various transit officials. And I'm not sure what the status of those are. Farhad, do you?
I believe there was a memo that went out from Rio responding to a couple of those questions. I have not received any responses from any of the transit providers. I don't recall there was anything else that was not addressed at the last meeting.
We'll follow up on that. I think you can see even in the meeting summary, a couple of the questions where information could be made available to us, which we haven't quite seen yet. So we'll follow up on that. Carolyn, do you want to kick us off?
Okay, sure. So going back to the consensus proposal that we voted on June 26th, we had for the transit element, we simply had, it was kind of a 30,000 foot level in the budget proposal, and simply had the same categories or subcategories as the multimodal roadways, capacity enhancements, operational enhancements. We had the new roadway, the new connections, modernization, and the only extra sub category in there was a high capacity transit. And so, the staff had mentioned that we needed more kind of definition to that. And the chair and I talked last week. So we got together, I call it a subcommittee of our group.
No committee. There was not a committee appointed.
Some group. And then, we had conversations and looking at numbers and categories really as late as this morning. So it's kind of not ready for prime time, but it's difficult sometimes because we can't get things out ahead of time unless we talk about it on the agenda. When you talk about it on the agenda, nobody's seen it. So hopefully people will have time to look at it. What I'd rather do is discuss kind of the concepts behind this and see what committee members have to say. But basically we took the subcategories or sub-elements that were on the 2006 ballot and the sub-elements that the staff had presented us to us quite a few times in the transit subcommittee and here. They were a little bit different, but pretty much the same. And so we looked at what kind of numbers would be appropriate in weekday evening service, weekend service expansion, frequency expansion, service area expansion, transit service for elderly and disabled, express service and park and ride, which was not recommended in the staff proposal, neighborhood circulators, and then of course the regional high capacity transit that we had before. And so our process was really reviewing the RTA 1 budget allocations, looking through again the regional long range transit plan, and then the SunTrans COA results and some of the recommendations and some of the public input and feedback that's gone through there. And I know that it's still in draft and they're going through another public input process. So we don't know what's gonna come out of that. But we thought that was important just because it shows the needs and the wants of people that are current bus riders and prospective bus riders. And we saw there was a need and want for increased frequency and new evening and weekend service. And we focused the budget additions on those sub-elements. We also heard from the public and CAC members that it's important to maintain existing service while expanding frequency, evening and weekend service. And we also, there was some conversation from CAC members about more park and rides. So that's how we kind of focused our input, our output, whatever, on this. And so we still have from our June 26th proposal, and then we got, of course, heard from the board that they weren't interested, at least at this time, in a point another tenth of a penny or in the baseline forecast. So it has the 1.217 in the multimodal roadways and in the public transit. That's 52% and the 30% for public transit and on. But the only thing different about this is we tried to suss out the subcategoricals as we have been seeing since the 2006 agenda. So that's kind of an overview. And Farhad and staff has mentioned that the $370 million is what will keep the current expansion from the 2006 monies that were passed. And so that was a given, the $370 million in keeping all the service that was recommended in, or that was given to us in 2006. And then we came out up with numbers according to the public feedback that we've heard in the various processes to for some monies for expansion.
Carolyn, just to clarify what you're talking about right now. So the percentages and the dollars that you showed there represent in each case enough to cover what that $370 million would presumably
right.
cover within the sub-elements. In other words, the 370 would be broken down somehow, probably based on the percentages from RTA 1.
Yes, I would the improvements that were done from, so it's kind of keeping that level and categories of what was funded in 2006 moving forward.
All right.
So I think that's what we've heard that was we wanted to do with the 370.
All right. Well, I think the committee is going to want to know, you know, within each of those, what's the delta? You know, how much above the,
right.
the 370 Absolutely. Would eat, you know, or right. portion of the 370 that each of these sub-elements represent.
Okay, well then what maybe we could share a screen and go over that, because we also looked at the staff's proposal for going forward from the transit element. The current funding allocation, and then this proposal. And when you talk about the delta, we have the additional monies, or less monies as it might be, from one to the other, and also the percentage of difference. Is that what you're asking?
Yeah. Yep. Okay. Let's take a look at that.
Okay. Moss, are you there? Can you share your screen?
Yep. 1 second.
I'll show you what we've worked up thus far, and hopefully it'll make sense and we can have a good conversation today amongst everybody. Can that get any bigger? That's the second. That's the second.
Yeah.
Do you want to look at this first in terms of the changes? Okay. Well,
I think so. Well, you can do a quick
okay,
review
yeah.
of the review you just gave us on the first sheet if you want.
Okay. Okay, there you have it. So like I said, all of the categories were the same amount of money as we had adopted in June. And then we took the $691 million that we adopted for transit and we broke that out. And so I can't see that far. Anyway,
Carolyn, I can try to just talk through it if it's helpful, since it's probably farther away. But essentially, yeah, this is the same number that we saw on June 26 when we adopted this framework. And so within these numbers, this is the total cost that is being proposed across these different sub-elements, which, as Carolyn said, align with what was in the RTA 1. And every single one of these dollar amounts maintains the current service and then expands upon it. The only exception is, I'm trying to make sure, I think the only, I think, you know, for the express service, this is more of a maintenance rather than an expansion of that based on some of the feedback that we have. So that's the one exception where we didn't increase from, add to what is needed to continue to provide the services. Instead, we're just proposing to maintain that at this time. So that's kind of the general sense of that. And we still include the regional high capacity transit to reflect what we've heard from the City of Tucson regarding the bus rapid transit projects that they've mentioned. So keeping that in there. Is there any questions or anything you wanted to add specifically on this spot, Carolyn, or otherwise can show the next page that has some of the comparisons about how this relates
to we'll look at the next page because I think that's what people want to see is comparisons from what we've seen and what happened in 2006. But I will say there were two differences. The express service expansion that we just maintained and not increased. There were a couple of reasons for that. One is just the feedback that we've, or the information that we've gotten from various professionals that it's not that cost effective and people aren't using it. And added to that, the increased investment in BRT, or I should say high capacity transit, plus the frequencies that it seems like everybody wants to see more frequency because they're more dependable. So when you put those two together, we think that that would be a place, where you could shift from express. And then the other one, there was no park and ride. There was no park and ride sub element in the staff's proposal. But we do have what we don't know exactly the amount, and hopefully we can find it, but it would include at least one additional park and ride. And then the circulator bus, there is an increase in that from the 2006 baseline, but in the long range regional transit plan, it says that less than 1% of the ridership in the region uses the neighborhood circulator system. So, and we have heard from Moro Valley that theirs is very popular. So we wanted to have some money in there for that. And that might be something we can look at further and get some feedback from the jurisdictions where in the places where these neighborhood circulator buses are driving. And so that's kind of the basis for our thought process thus far. So here's the comparison, and the RTA, the RTA one is on the first column, obviously. Staff proposal, the second one, and then the CAC proposal. So RTA one was what was on the ballot. And then the RTA current costs on the very other end of it is what we've seen from staff that, you know, the things got cut or whatever happened with transit. So there's less money in that column than there was in the RTA one column in a lot of instances.
Carolyn, can we pause for just a second? Sure. I'd like to ask Farhad if the breakdown of the RTA current costs reflects essentially a breakdown that expecting that money would be spent for to maintain. It's a little different than just saying this is what we're going to need as a proposal to maintain each of these elements, as opposed to this is what we've been spending.
Yeah.
Today.
So, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, I have not seen this before. This is the first time I'm seeing this as well. So I need to confirm those numbers. But your question, your concern is valid. Obviously, we still have 3 years remaining, and those projections potentially could change based on the next 3 years where the demand is. So I would not use that as a solid number, even if the numbers are correct, they're subject to change. So that's on the last column, on the current RTA cost column. The staff proposal column, I'm not sure where those numbers are coming from. Staff has not proposed anything. I believe that is the subcommittee's recommendation. I believe that's what you mean. So that's based on the transit subcommittee's recommendation, not staff proposal.
Okay, well, I just to clarify that those numbers in RTA current cost are what we've been seeing from staff, and that is what's being compared to the, what you're calling the adopted allocation. And I don't think that the subcommittee ever changed any numbers that initially came from staff when we started meeting as a subcommittee.
The first round of the subcommittee work into that. Simply ratifying that as yes. This position to go forward. The second go around, more recently, the committee didn't come to any conclusion, and so essentially that original has been the only the only thing exactly. That was recommended before.
Okay, so I mean, just to clarify again, the RTA current costs came right out of what we've been seeing from hockey. And then the from the CAC Transit Element Subcommittee, what was given to us, and still is what like 3 years ago or whatever it was that was voted on. Those are the numbers.
If I may, Mr. Chair, again, I want to clarify what the chair mentioned. So the 370 is current projection, but that is subject to change based on our needs over the next 3 years.
Okay, well, I understand. We were just using the same comparative as we've been seeing. Okay, thank you. Because I don't think that number's changed since we started looking at it, or has it?
It may change again soon, so it's subject to change.
No, but I think this is what we've seen.
Yeah, that's what we've had recently. Yes, you're correct. Okay. But I guess that's a valid point that as the needs obviously arise, those numbers will be adjusted. So the two areas that we know we have high demand, obviously, is our ADA services. Those demands continue to demonstrate that there's a lot of need and there's going to be growth in that area. And the circulators, I want to mention that everybody recognizes the circulators in some cases are providing lifeline services to areas that have no transit at all. And those are the areas that we see opportunities for additional expansion. Vail, for example, is one of them. So the reason that at that time, the subcommittee agreed that we need to invest more in those circulators was because of areas that have no transit. Therefore, we need to provide a transit option.
Yeah, and we also realized that particular category could change. I mean, they all could change. We could have put a lot more money into our recommendation, but, you know, that money, considering that the ADA law and, you know, what it has to provide, and then I think we provide a little bit more than that. So these numbers, there are some issues that would need to be worked out, but I'll just compare the staff / first transit subcommittee recommendation to this committee numbers with the RTA with this proposal, and we can, and I've got the delta proportion percentages down too on the next page, but here's the difference. So
again, staff proposal is kind of the still existing, I guess, subcommittee information.
Right. Okay, we'll call it that. Transit subcommittee confirmation recommendation. So that and it also, I should say, is the TMC TMC recommendation, because that was included in what they approved when they did the corridor project. So I guess we can call it that too, TMC. But that, I'll just, I mean, you guys can read it, but The weekend evening service expansion, 33.4 million in, well, I just call it the TMC now, TMC. And our proposal is 35.5 million. So there's a 2 million plus difference there. Weekend service expansion, the TMC, 26.8 million for weekend service expansion. Weekend service, I should say these are weekend service plus expansion because it's all inclusive here. I think, Moss, no, this is just the expansion. Okay, so, and then in the frequency expansion, the TMC is 7.1 million. And this is, can't see that far. 96.74. So that's a big difference here with the frequency expansion, 89.6 million difference. Service area expansion, the TMC 4 million, and this CAC proposal is 34.5 million. So there's a big difference there. And then transit service, elderly and disabled, 38.4 in the TMC, and ours is 41.87. So that's a 3 million plus difference. Express service enhancement, the staff proposed to have that go down from the last RTA, and we just have it staying steady. So we have a $1.2 million difference going the other way. Park and ride, the TMC didn't have any money for park and rides, and we have 3.45 million. So that's a 3.45 million difference. And then the biggest down difference here, well, not the biggest, but 30.7 million that the TMC is recommending. And this proposal has just 2.75 in expansion. So that's a difference of 27.9 less.
Explain that. You have the proposal is 70 million on the previous page.
Which?
For,
so this is, yeah, I gotcha. So this would be the total, including maintaining the current. So basically what we did, if you take this 45.8 and you add the 2.7, then you'll get this. This total, or for in the staff case, you'll get the 76 by adding 45 plus the 30. So that's kind of, we're just trying to show,
break it down,
you know, like, you know, saying, assuming like we're maintaining what these, you know, estimated projected costs are for this moment that might change. We're using that and then saying like, well, but what are we going to do beyond that rather than maintaining? And so that's what this table is attempting to help illustrate, is between the different proposals out there, what would be in addition to maintaining service.
So in a different way, I'll say the 533.8 million was what was on the 2006 ballot, and that includes the regional high capacity, the streetcar. And we weren't dealing with the streetcar as much as the element, the sub-elements within the, you know, the fixed route and such. And then the staff's, I mean, the this proposal, 510, basically 510 million, which is what we've got for the TMC proposal. And then 691 million for the June 26 consensus proposal. And then the 370, of course, was what we currently have as the current funding allocation, which may change, but that's the only numbers we had now. So the second one is just the additional over the 370 of current funding allocation. Did we make it more confusing, not less?
A little bit, but basically what you're saying is that you're raising these sub-elements, 111 billion four.
Right.
But not counting the high-capacity trailer.
Exactly. Thank you.
Okay. We do have a question from Jamie, but Farhad, you want
to? I was just going to ask, it's helpful to have that delta, I guess. We've had this conversation before. Where's that 111 coming from?
It's just the total of the difference column.
I know, and but where in the overall budget, Mr. Chair, in the overall budget, $111 million has to come from a different element. Which element is it coming from?
Right. Well, we were asked just to look at the breakdown of the transit. So I don't know that it sounds like we're going to be doing that in the prioritization and everything else, not this particular exercise. Was just about the breakdown of the transit.
Yeah,
well, Farhad, just to kind of elaborate on that, that this totals with this 111 to the adopted 691 million that we did on June 26. So it's totally in alignment with the previous framework that we passed 18-6. So it's all balanced and everything. And as you'll see up here, that this total adds up to the 2.3 billion. We have 1.6 billion going to named projects, and we have the admin, but debt service, small business assistance in alignment with what staff has presented to us. So this is ticking all the boxes that the board has directed us to be within the 5-cent sales tax and allocating the 1.1 billion to name projects. So we're all in alignment on that front. And this is not a new number for the committee to see. And so this is just essentially taking the previous sub-elements that voters are familiar with and dividing that adopted number and sorting out kind of how that will look, which was also part of the motion that Patricia made and was passed 18-6 on June 26th. So this is all just in line with that.
I understand. I think the question was simply, what's been, if these are being increased, then what's being decreased? And we know from that the named projects or the corridor projects are being reduced. And I think the rest of the sub-elements are within range of where we've been discussing them for the last few years. So that's the point I was making at the beginning, that together with finding money for transit, we'll have to prioritize the corridor projects. And that's the exercise that I hope to get kicked off here in the next week or so for us to work on.
Just to clarify on that, Tom, I mean, we don't really have to find money for transit. We've had the budget set. And so then it's really just going back to the projects and talking to the jurisdictions and trying to, on that side, work within this dollar amount that we adopted. And so this isn't, the part of the reason there's 111 here versus what was the TMC adopted is just because we have the CAC recommending a higher public transit budget element than what the TMC adopted. So that's where that's coming from. And I don't think we really need to find any dollars for it since that's what we adopted.
Mr. Chair, thank you for that statement, because now I think I understand what's being proposed. So it looks like it's roughly $230 million reduction from the corridor projects, right?
Isn't new, just to be very clear. This is something that was previously adopted. So just like
because the deferred projects were moved into that same budget. As you
So we're not, again, I just want to understand because I haven't seen this before. So we're not meeting the $1.1 billion for new corridor projects.
Board didn't specify new named projects. They said there need to be $1.1 billion for named projects. And it also didn't have to be road pride projects. So this can encompass also the $70 million that is being considered for high capacity transit. And also the other named projects that have the TMC recommended getting moved to the active transportation and safety elements. So this does tick it. This is what we discussed a couple weeks ago, over a month ago, and adopted 18-6 Farhad, if you recall that. And I have the kind of the information up here summarizing what that motion was.
I understand you don't want to say that we're taking money from somewhere because this is what was adopted. I think all the reason that we brought this up is to try to understand where that money would be spent over and above the currently estimated amount to maintain services. We have another $100 million of investment that is being proposed and has been carried forward from our June 26th vote. But the committee needs to understand, because not only was it not expressed in terms that we've been using as put it in, but we couldn't really see where those changes were coming and what was justifying them. And that's the reason for the conversation that's going on.
I just want to clarify for the record, RTA board directed $1.1 billion for the new corridor named projects as they established those parameters. And I believe every conversation we've had since then, especially with the TMC, the $1.1 billion is the target for corridor projects.
Yes, for corridor projects, but not specific to that. And I think we can get a transcript if there's any more confusion on that, Farhad. So,
I mean, $230 million for the four deferred projects, again, direction by the board, comes from the top. That's separate from this equation. So I think just to make sure we're being clear, not confusing the committee members, the 2230 has to come off the top. And then I think that's where the difference is.
Yes.
Again, Farhad, actually, the transcript from the board does not specify that it has to come off the top. And we've repeatedly tried to correct this confusion. It seems that staff might have about that. And if you want, I can work on pulling the transcript and making sure that it's known that it's not the 1.1 is not specific to, was not stated as needing to be specific to new projects. And there was no direction from the board to make those deferred projects come off the top, recognizing that it would just eat from all the rest of the categoricals and overinflate the roadway projects. So that might be your interpretation, but that's not what was stated. And I just hope we can continue to keep that straight. And I'm happy to get transcripts if that's helpful.
Thanks, Moss. And I just want to add too, there's also the $10 million in bus corridor pullouts that move over. So this is the same. The only difference in this than what you've seen and sent out and we approved is the breakdown in the transit sub element. That's the only difference. So, but you're correct.
Okay.
That's what we do. Thank you.
Jamie.
Thank you. So I guess I have a couple dumb questions. When we approve this, we keep talking about approving it, but I thought there was an amendment in which we only approve that if the additional funding would be provided, that extra half cent, so that we agreed to increase the transit budget if we could increase the overall budget. And am I left field on this one?
So I went and pulled this just so that there's no confusion, Jamie, because totally hear it's kind of hard to hear everything that happens in a meeting on the fly. So I went and got the transcript from that video, and this is the friendly amendment that Kevin made. So as you'll see here, it was Patricia's was to adopt the framework. And then Kevin said that is to also make a recommendation. So in addition to make a recommendation to go to the 610 sales tax that would restore the roadway projects. So there was nothing else stated after that about if the board doesn't want to do that, then we scrap the framework. This was the transcript that was stated from that meeting and what we voted on.
So Moss, you're being disingenuous here. So
I'm not
approved this vote because
you voted no.
We could get all the roadway projects in and we could get the increase in transit.
Jamie, I think you voted no.
6 cents. If we can't get the 6 cents, then we can't say that this is approved. I mean, this town of Boyd.
I understand you may have, yeah. Jamie, I understand you may have misheard it. And I, as I recall, you voted no on this. So you didn't approve it under with that understanding. And this is directly, you can go back and listen to the meeting minutes, the recording. And this is exactly what is stated word for word.
Yeah, but I think a reasonable person would say it's all part and parcel. So I
wouldn't have voted for it if
this was approved.
My understanding was this, it was in addition to, it wasn't contingent upon. That's why I voted yes. So I don't really, because that's what I heard in the call. So
us and Jamie both, that's the reason that we're talking about this, both to clarify where the money's to be spent and how, as well as to be able to ratify what we did before with a straight up half cent sales tax vote with no confusion, if you will, built in. We'll probably confuse ourselves some other way, but it's my goal not to confuse us over the extra 10th if some people were at all confused to begin with. I have Bruce here, and then I have Eva after that.
Yeah, I guess I would like to try to get to that same issue. I think we're unnecessarily complicating this at this point. The name projects are still a moving target because we need to see the cost estimates and those kinds of things that we're talking about going back and having to reprioritize those. I think we should take this transit discussion in the context of this and speak to the commitments and the purpose and the mission that we're trying to embrace with these numbers and have that discussion and come to the end of that. And then we're going to have to come back and reconcile these all against a final budget at the end. And I've resisted the notion that if we add something to transit right now, we have to subtract something from main projects or vice versa. I'm trying to get through the discussion of what are our transit priorities, where is the need, what we think are reasonable allocations of those monies. And once we've completed that process, I would suggest that we bring it back with the categoricals and the name projects after we've gone through that exercise and try to rationalize and reconcile those differences. Do that now, it seems to me just to be going in circles.
Yeah, exactly. And the proposal which we're left with, as we've seen here, will also require board authorization, if you will. They did say it was a starting point, but there, as Farhad has said, there are a number of people who believe that the 1.1 was the target. So we can talk to them about exactly what they said and that, but we're going to go forward with what this committee recommends. All right. It may not fit what the board was looking for. And they know at this point, more or less, where we're going. So we'll get some feedback from them, I'm sure, if this is not where we're going to.
Could I just finish? I think there are three big things that we need to look at in this proposal. One is significantly proposing expansion of service. Secondly, is adding a high capacity project to it. And third, it is reducing the amount of money for neighborhood circulators. It seems to me that each of those items needs to undergo discussion amongst this committee as to whether that's the right priorities. Then we can make the final decision about where we go.
Thank you. Agreed. I agree with that.
I just want to comment on that, if I may. So thank you for that. That conversation obviously is ongoing. But I would recommend all members to review the long-range transit plan. The long-range transit plan did exactly what you just described, and what's being proposed is not consistent with that proposal.
You want to elaborate a couple of
friends? Park and Ride is the simplest one. Long-range transit plan specifically interviewed all of our entities, talked to everybody, and there was no recommendation or need for additional park and ride. So that was one specific one that I can talk about. Neighborhood circulators, another recommendation that they insisted that we need to provide transit services where we do not currently have transit services. So that's where you get the most return on the investment. So that was the second one, high capacity transit, another one. There was no recommendation for doing high capacity transit. Instead, there was recommendation to focus on frequency first. Frequency first, you are providing opportunities for multiple routes instead of just one route. So again, please take a look at that long range plan study. It was unanimously supported by everyone. We were directed to implement those recommendations. And all I'm suggesting is please take a look at it. Make sure that your recommendations are consistent with that as well.
And if I could just jump in and explain some of the things.
You'll get a chance. Hang on.
And I guess notwithstanding those recommendations, it is the prerogative of this committee to go back and review and add a different perspective or change to that. And I will just use one example. If you were to adopt a high capacity transit project, you might want to have park divide as part of that, or it might not be warranted as part of our current transit system. So my whole point is that I think that it's legitimate for the committee to discuss each of these, notwithstanding they might in fact be in conflict with the long range plan.
Yeah, and I think that conversation is exactly what I had hoped for, and I really appreciate the way it's presented here in different forms so that we can zero in on those very questions and also so that we can face straight up those inconsistencies that Farhad has been talking about.
Tom, I just wanted to address those notes just because, as Carolyn said early on, we did reference and review the long-range regional transportation plan. So regarding the neighborhood circulators, you'll see here that we are absolutely maintaining that service. And we're in fact increasing from what is projected to be need to maintain. So it would offer opportunity for jurisdictions to expand that service in RTA next, given this proposal. So that is totally in alignment with the long range regional transportation plan. And as part of our responsibility as CIC, as we've been reminded, is to also bring the voices of the community. And we've heard from a number of folks here that park and rides are seen as a valuable place. Bruce just said things really eloquently about that. And the other thing to note about the circulators, just to bring into context why this number seemed too high, that staff or TMC were bringing forward, because this serves 1% of riders in our region. And so in addition, you'll see the incredible investment in frequency expansion, which is, as noted, in line with the long-range regional transportation plan. And by increasing frequency and also simultaneously expansion, providing expansion to the service area, which is much larger than what was proposed by TMC, that this would enable to fill any gaps that this service is currently supporting. So yeah, our region is growing, and it makes sense that we would continue to grow and extend the tendrils of our public transportation system through this frequency and service area investment. And then that would mean that we could continue to maintain this really important circulator bus that serves 1% of our ridership in the region, and grow it a little bit if needed, but also maybe reconfigure where that is going, so that this cost effectively increases coverage, and then this can supplement that as it should be. So I just wanted to really quickly address those what was labeled as inconsistencies to illustrate that we're really not being inconsistent, and actually we're really in line with what that plan says. And then also this is really reflects the feedback that the SunTran gathered through their COA, which was in joint with City of Tucson and PAG. So this is really taking in a lot of data from our region and from professionals and experts. And I know that's really important to so many of us on this committee to have expert input and also community input. And this reflects that. So thank you.
I've had my hand up for a while.
Yeah, I know, Eva. Jamie, did you just leave your hand up, or did I cut you off before you finished your question?
I just accidentally left it up.
Okay, go ahead, Eva.
You know, I just wanted to say, per Jamie's comment about, you know, no reasonable person would be voting for what we voted for without that increase to the budget. I knew very well that without that increase to the budget, how that was going to impact how spending was allocated. And that was the point to me, okay? July 2023 was the hottest month on global temperature record. I don't know if you, people aren't aware of that. Think about it, let it set in, okay? And fossil fuels, greenhouse gas emissions from transportation, that accounts for almost 30% of total US greenhouse gases. So I don't know if I'm like hallucinating this past summer and nobody else was, you know, in Tucson with me or in Phoenix with me or in Greece with me or, you know, smelling the smoke from the Canada wildfires in Iowa all in the same summer. But I mean, we need to do better. And, you know, that's what we're trying to do, is do better so that our children and our grandchildren can continue to live in the most rapid warming city in the West. Okay, so I want to reframe that, right? Like, who in their right mind votes for more greenhouse gas emissions? Who in their right mind votes for not thinking about the future of the place that we live and how we're going to continue to survive here? I just want that to be clear. I knew exactly what I was doing when I voted.
All right, thank you.
Dale, and then we're going to go item by item, at least briefly, so that people can say what they they think about those. Because Moss did a good job of kind of giving an overview of the thought process and developing things. Go ahead.
I want to agree with Moss.
Dale, close to the microphone.
Yes. I wanted to agree with Moss to a degree, but I also have, I think we got a kind of a miss. To me, we're putting the cart before the horse a little bit on neighborhood circulators. Because through my time of looking at it, neighborhood circulators are actually a way to expand service area. And I think to a certain extent, my only objection here is that I think service area expansion should include the expansion of neighborhood circulators. And I think somehow we're trying to define something that will be more defined in the future as we go forward, as we see the community develop and where there are demands. I mean, a whole lot of what we're talking about is that congestion will increase and other reasons, including global warming, for those who don't disagree that it exists, those the factors are going to kind of define what the kind of service is that's going to be needed out there. So when we talk about service area expansion, I think the cart has to go that we need money for service area expansion, but some of that expansion may be in the nature of neighborhood circulators. And so I think we're getting too defined in the future as to which type of service is added in the future.
So Dale, from that comment, would you suggest maybe reducing the $66 million for service area expansion and instead transfer some of that money to the neighborhood circulators, say?
I would change it. I'd leave the neighborhood circulators just exactly where they're at to maintain the current service, and then I would put it to service area expansion, that service area expansion can be done in whatever is the best definable system when we're looking at actually authorizing that neighborhood expansion. So that some of that service area expansion money could be used for neighborhood circulator expansion, if that's where the need is.
And if I may add to that, again, going back to the long range plan and the workshops we had throughout the region, one of the reasons that we were focusing on more investments in those neighborhood circulators was exactly what you described, Dale. Like currently, they don't have a transit option. And if they had that transit option, those circulators connect to other transit routes. Therefore, you're actually increasing ridership by providing that additional opportunity. So by definition, yes, you're correct. That's expanding the service area because now you're connecting the circulators to the existing routes. And so you can look at it either way, but I agree with what you said, Dale. To us, that's one tool in increasing ridership to give people options to choose to ride the transit system and make sure it's seamless and connects to other services within the region.
I'll point out that the what's called staff proposal, TMC, if you will, is a total of 112 million. And the proposal that we see here is 114 million. So between those two, between the neighborhood circulator and the service area expansion, we're essentially talking about keeping that sum about the same in this proposal. Does that make sense? And Farhad, I think the specific question was, could you use service area expansion money? In fact, I guess the board isn't going to be bound by what these numbers are.
Again, I agree with you, Dale, and thank you, Mr. Chair. I agree. You can mix and match those two. Obviously, it depends on how we describe it on the ballot, but the intent is the same. Yes.
And just to, Dale, kind of help illustrate, when you look at the long-range transportation plan, there's a medium-term cost and benefits section, and on there, it has about 2.2 million per year as far as the suburban Southern Shuttle suburban improvements. Whereas, and then there's like 11.2 million for frequent transit network improvement or expansion. Sorry. So you can see that the scale of the investment that is recommended in that plan is different. That it's higher for the service area expansion. And then in total for expanding evening and weekend services, it's looking at about 27.1 million per year increase is what that long range plan recommends. So by contrast, the long range regional transportation plan is only recommending about a 2.2 million suburban increase for the neighborhood circulator rather than other things that are at much greater scale. So totally agree with you that there's synergy happening between those and happy to fiddle with numbers and hopefully get some input from SunTran about what they would think.
Yeah, just to further, expand on that. This is the comparison with we have in this proposal, we have the current funding allocation for the last RTA. One was 45.8. And at least right now, and so we have added to that. We're not taking anything away from, we're just not expanding it as much as the staff / TMC proposal, or I should say recommendation. And so 45.8 million was what we got as the current funding allocation thus far. We have 48.5, and then the staff was, we're not quite doubling it in the one that made it into the TMC recommendation was 76.5 million. And just it seemed like there's a room for expansion, but and also from the transit plan, if it's less than 1% of the ridership, we might be able to get that kind of neighborhood circulation in different ways. It talks about the dial rides and the things like that, as opposed to the neighborhood circulator that might cost less. So I think we're still going in the same direction, which is up. It's just not drastically increasing it. And again, as far as it's all just a, you know, it's about, do we want frequency or do we want, we want it all, of course, but you know, what is the most important for the community? Is it more frequency to get more people on the bus system or is it the neighborhood circulator bus? So it's kind of a push and pull. That's what we're trying, at least so far, to do here. and I want to hear from more people, so I'll try to keep it to myself for a while.
Okay. Start at the top, unless somebody has a burning issue somewhere else. Weekday evening service expansion looks like about the same, a little bit more than was recommended. Well, staff proposal, but I want to comment on that one. Weekend service expansion. This is 15 or so percent beyond and more than double current investment. Does that make sense? Is that a can we even do that? We can double our weekend service at an area, that expansion, or just the service itself, meaning frequency and geography?
Yeah, good question, Mr. Chair. So we believe that we've provided weekend service expansions to all the routes that were productive and able to use that expansion. So the 51 was a reasonable number, so additional 8 million, I think it's still reasonable, but you're right, it may not even have the need for it.
Just
something to keep in mind is, you know, since we're looking at the next 20 years, and if we're proposing frequency and service expansion, that might mean that in 15 years from now, there would be reason to do weekend and weekday expansion. So just trying to, again, make sure that we're looking at things holistically and how they will relate to each other. When you invest in one area, it could lead to needs down the road given the term of this plan and tax.
No question, it's an interrelated series of sub-elements here. The one that did catch my attention the most probably is this next one, the frequency expansion of nearly 100 million over or beyond what is needed to essentially maintain where we are today. Is that as simple as saying everything goes to half of the schedule, or double the amount of stops? In other words, we're going to go from 30 to 15 everywhere where there are 30-minute headways, and then we're going to go from 15 to 10 everywhere else.
If I may add some context to that. So again, currently we believe the frequent network is obviously performing well. So the $86 million was based on the network. As you mentioned, obviously you can increase frequency in some areas, but 15-minute or 10-minute frequency is what's being targeted right now, and the 86 was sufficient for the frequent network. Obviously, you can always enhance that. You can add additional routes to the network, but again, that's subject to SDOA to identify networks that are potentially have the demand for additional frequency.
Yeah, and I think Bruce has said this really well. You know, when we're investing this much, it's really about, and also I think Carolyn's really well put out about how you know, we've underinvested in transit for the last 20 years, and you know, if we're going to invest in it this way, we need to make sure it's frequent and usable to people. 30 minutes is not really a reasonable or usable thing, and especially if you miss it, you're definitely going to be late to work at that time scale. So Tom, exactly what you were describing, increasing the frequency, 10 minutes is my understanding of what's really the target for what is a good level of service for transit users as far as reliability and just timing, makes it far more convenient and usable. So this will be really important for doing that. And yes, I think it would be everywhere in our region so that, you know, you can reliably get to the places in a timely manner through this deep investment.
Good question for Farhad. If you invest in the way that this is showing, what do you use to, can you use that money to buy the additional equipment that you'll need? Provide that. I mean, obviously, if you increase not just the frequent network, but the entire network down to 15 minutes, whatever. Going to have to buy a lot more buses.
Exactly. So the way we operate as a taxing district, we would contract with the transit provider. And if the intent is to provide additional capital investments as well as operational investments for that additional frequency, that would be eligible through the RTA process. But again, I would highly suggest that you have to keep in mind that if there is a demand for that additional enhancement, if the demand is not there, then obviously as an agency, we cannot justify that. So that the numbers, as you discussed them, doubling that to 176, I don't know off the top of my head if there's demand for that, but keep that in mind.
And just to kind of draw back the Move Tucson plan, as I recall, there was a lot of demand expressed through that lengthy public process recently from people about wanting to have more opportunities for using public transit. And so this would be in line in that and feeding that regional need that has recently been identified. And we heard last meeting quite a bit about the risk from the COA and the deep concerns about cutting routes at the expense of weekend and weekday service. So it was really presented to us as an either or. And so this type of investment could help to ensure that we are keeping our existing transit network whole while also meeting the needs expressed through that COA process, which was to increase frequency and weekend and weekday service.
Arlen.
Thanks. So doing a quick snapshot analysis of any of these is very difficult, just like it was very difficult to put them together. But the group was asked to further define, well, what does that mean? What does it mean for each of these categories to put in? So from that perspective, if we start thinking about the next 20 years of what this place is going to look like, it's not going to look like it looks today. Some of it will, because it's land that has been tied up in single family homes on one house per acre or greater. That's probably not going to change too much except for an occasional infill. But what is going to change in the community and what can be facilitated before changing is more development, denser development, as we convert unnecessary shopping centers, unnecessary parking lots into higher density housing. And I'm not talking about university skyscraper type dorms. I'm talking about things along major arterials that people can live in. So rethinking how our arterials are going to basically, and they are today being blown up and started over again with a different land use pattern. So from that perspective, making sure that whether the category is frequency expansion or any of these other expansions, or even as I was mentioned, the neighborhood circulator, the expansion of these areas, just like the SunTran streetcar, thank you. is bringing about new development in the downtown, this will happen along our major arterials. And so we need to start thinking about it, tying together what we do with transit, how we factor all these things in, and how they can work at the same time with the expansion of these development areas. It's more jobs, it's more development, it's more people utilizing the system. They cannot all be in cars. Otherwise, basically, the parking lots, which used to be on the individual property, will be the streets. So I'm looking at this long-term and how this would all work. So we were asked, I think the group was asked to further divide this out. This is a proposal. And then how to, you know, it's this. It's still going to be this because we're not traffic engineers. We're not transportation planners. But all these things put together can yield and make that change into the future, I think, more real and, frankly, better for all of us economically. That's it.
Okay, thank you. Bruce?
Yeah, I was just about to say the same thing as Arlen. When we sat down and worked on this, if you look at frequency expansion, service area expansion, neighborhood circulators, they're all interrelated. They're not, they don't stand apart. They're not discrete categories. And so what's going to happen over the next 20 years is going to define how those dollars should be used. We're sort of being asked to make arbitrary assignments of dollars to the amounts, but in fact, what we're saying is that there needs to be a bigger pot of money to address the transit requirements of this region going forward. You know, if you talk about frequency expansion, well, if you have higher densification, you're going to have more people using the transit system, you may need higher frequency. On the other hand, we're seeing rapid growth in places like Vail and Oral Valley and Marana. And so connecting the expanding service delivery is important too. And then as Laura had made the point, you know, the neighborhood circulators connect and feed the system. I'm frustrated that we as non-planners have to make a decision about allocating these against these discrete categories, rather than saying what you're saying as a CAC, we want to allocate 30% of the regional transportation dollars to the transit system to make it work. And
yeah, I get the frustration, but the flip side of that is that questions about each of these elements is going to be asked, and we need to be able to explain and convince the voting public that this is what can do with that money. This is what is planned to be done with that money, and you can count on that as a ballot promise. And you know, it's I think that's all we're doing right now as a committee is just asking those questions about what is likely to be provided. What does the community say so far that is important to them? You know, through the, as Moss had talked about, through the long range transit plan, through Move Tucson, and through the COA. And remember, there will also be more input as soon as the board moves this forward for vetting among the public. So I think there's we're doing the best we can right now with what we know of public opinion.
And just, I would say, recognizing that I'm almost going to suggest that when we bring the policy considerations back off the table, that we include a notion there is that there has to be a degree of flexibility and a recognition that these are integrated and interconnected activities. I don't know how you word that in a ballot, and I think you have to sell it to the general public, but I think we would be making a huge mistake to try to freeze things into such rigid categories that they don't recognize this interrelationship among us.
It's kind of a question that I had asked that Farhad was asked two or three questions at once, but I want to ask it again about the flexibility within sub-elements that the board might have for reallocating any of that 10 years from now. Or
yeah, so of course, again, the commitment is to meet those obligations. So if we're able to meet those obligations, and I think there's flexibility beyond that baseline. Once we reach that baseline, let's say, for the sake of discussion, example that that Bruce is using, if we already made the baseline for frequency expansion and we need to spend more on a different sub-element, then yes, that flexibility is there.
Yeah, we're describing what it is that we want to achieve with each of these sub-elements, and assuming that the board declares that we're meeting that, and there's additional funds that could be shipped. Just trying for the committee to have an understanding of what flexibility there might be built in, and you can even probably give us some examples of how that's been used to date. Back by looking at the current costs versus the sub-elements from RTA 1,
correct.
I probably get a...
There's been some flexibility there already, yes. So again, just as an example, it is obviously a document, a commitment to the public, and then we do have our performance reviews every 5 years, and so moving forward. So we always want to make sure that we come back and demonstrate that we're meeting the baseline. And that's really the intent. In some cases, if there's no demand, and that's where I go back to this phrase, if there's no demand, obviously the governing body has that authority to move funds from one sub-element to another sub-element where there is justified demand.
Right, Carolyn.
Mr. Chair, yeah, I was gonna try to wanted to answer your question about coming up with these numbers. And I will say that the long range regional transit plan starts out talking about how people will get on transit. They want to have they want to be able to depend on something 7 days a week. So that is those top three, which are most important, the weekday, evening and the weekend, and certainly the frequency expansion. And also the COA, we'll be finding out in the COA review that is out for comment again right now. In the first round of public comments, that is what people were demanding, more frequency. And so what we're seeing in this recommendation is that they are putting more frequency in, but it's to the at the expense of some very popular routes. So we're trying to look at that and say, well, you know, if the COA is cutting somewhere, maybe we can put it back in. And that's what we're trying to get at, was what we've heard from the public. And I will say also, the frequency expansion, and I guess because of that flexibility, in I think it was the third quarter, there were frequencies that weren't delivered that were supposed to be. And I will say to 10 minutes, because I've been looking at this, at least in the latest SunTrans schedules, the number 6, the number 11, the number 15, and the number 16 I was just on the other day, actually, but those were supposed to get to 10 minute service and they're still at 15. So these were things that we were supposed to get delivered before, and then going to 15 minute service, the 3, the 6, the 7, the 9, the 10, the 19, and the 27. So, I mean, I'm just saying that there were things that the public did vote on and were expecting. I should say vote on that specifically, but that was in the plan, and now they weren't done. So we're also trying to, in addition to the RTA current costs, the costs that were cut before, we're trying to make sure that that's addressed here. And again, those top three are the ones that in Move Tucson and the COA and in the long range regional transit plan, we continue to hear that those are the most important things. So that's where that it wasn't like what I wanted to see in there. It was what the current bus riders and the prospective bus riders are already saying out in the public.
That's so those top three were going to have spent together almost exactly what was promised. It looks like, you know, you've got about 6 million more than RTA 1 voters agreed for weekday evening, and then you have about 5 million more for the weekend service, and then about 10 million less, which is about to essentially wash among those three, in frequency expansion and service area expansion, though, is considerably different.
$2,006. So again, just
quick note on that, Tom, the frequency expansion and service area were combined.
Please.
Okay, I was answering your question.
I know, and I will call on you.
Okay. Well, you asked a question that I about the proposal that I worked on, and I can address it. So I.
You will.
So, Mr. Chair, again, going back to what we talked about, making sure that there's demand for it. And then the purpose of the COA is really critical in this decision-making process. So I'll use the frequency example that you used. If the COA is coming back and the COA doesn't confirm the need for that additional frequency enhancements, then that's why they were not implemented. So that's moving forward. Same thing. The COA is really not intended to be a plan per se. It's to confirm efficiency and the need for those services and the demand. And if the demand isn't there, then therefore those investments haven't been made yet. Once the demand is there, obviously we can make those investments. So the frequency is a good example of that. We're about $10 million short of what was in the current ballot. But the demand was just not demonstrated because we focused on those frequent networks. We didn't expand and go beyond that. Same thing back to your question, Tom, expansion. Expansion is expensive. Most providers do not even recommend expansions. We've had in the previous COAs that they wanted to actually reduce the service area because it's just not cost effective and the demand isn't there. So that's the reason, going back to your question, Chair, that there was no request for additional expansion because they didn't see the demand for it.
Okay. Moss, go ahead.
That I just wanted to explain to clarify on the table that these numbers here are hard to compare, not only because they're in $2,006, but also as noted down here, these were originally combined. And as, you know, I think appropriately so, they were broken out since they are pretty different things. And this is just a rough thing. So really comparing what was done here doesn't make any sense to do. So just wanted to provide that clarity. This is the total number if you combine these two of what was displayed on the ballot, and there wasn't any detail about how that was divvied up further.
Just Mr. Chair, just to clarify, that was at the request of the transit subcommittee to divide those. You're correct. Those were combined on the ballot, but the transit subcommittee, and I believe you were probably the one who asked for it, separating those two items.
Right. I voted against that.
Actually, you voted in favor of it. I'll double check.
That part, but I didn't vote in favor of the adopted allegation, as we're calling it.
Let's get the tape out. Confirm that.
Just did.
Dale?
You know, I'm going to try to summarize here. I do not have a problem with the bottom line number here. I know it's going to impact roadway projects. I understand that, and I understand the whole argument about the meeting that I wasn't here at, but I don't have a real problem with the number here. And my biggest issue beyond that is I think this is a reasonable allocation when we talk about, you know, and when I was on the transit task force, these were the same priorities we were discussing then. It's still the same priorities now. And I think it's important that there be more money and that that more money be able to be flexibly spent under the ballot proposition to expand the service as quickly and as efficiently as we can. And so, you know, I said, overall, I have no objection. I'm not going to argue with any of these specific numbers other than the flexibility of making the money go as far and as quickly as we can. So.
Thank you. Thank everyone for your comments. I have Abby, and then we'll talk about next steps. Abby.
Thanks, Tom. Can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I just keep hearing the term demand used. So I just want to raise a point here. I mean, where we fund can help orient where demand is. And we talked about this in the past with induced demand in terms of adding lanes to roads and inducing more people to drive. The same thing happens with public services. The more neglected and starved a public service is, the less demand there is for it. Post office is a good example, and bus routes are also a good example. The less convenient, the less frequent, the less accessible, quite frankly, the more dirty a bus is, the less demand there is for it. So I think that this is, I think that waiting for some magical demand to pop up as opposed to shifting our priorities to address what Ava discussed before and what a lot of us have discussed nonstop about climate change and adaptability. Farhad mentioned this in terms of neighborhood access, plugging people into larger routes. We need to fund these systems to increase the demand. We don't wait for demand to pop up out of nowhere. So I really hope that we're not waiting for demand for services that haven't yet proven themselves and haven't yet been provided. We do have to lead with that. So I just wanted to raise that.
Okay, thanks for that. Our next steps will be at our next meeting to discuss the other elements and sub-elements and to hopefully have gotten started at least on establishing priorities for the corridor projects. If we're going to recommend something other than 1.1 billion plus 230 billion as corridor projects, then we'll have to say which ones those are. So by the time we meet next, hopefully we'll be in the midst of that process as a committee. And we'll continue to talk. And we still owe, just even looking at the notes from the meeting summary, there's still some information in there about transit that hasn't yet surfaced for us all to have. That is what I see for the coming meeting. Carolyn?
Yes, what I would suggest and request, Farhad mentioned reading again the Long Range Regional Transit Plan. And along with what Dale was saying, that there's the total money, but there's also moving things around in the sub-element. So I would love to hear anybody else's, without doing it like in real time, at the meeting to look at the we should send out what we put together that was just shown here and ask everybody, especially the ones that are on the transit, have been on the transit subcommittee, to look at those and think about it a little more carefully in your free time. And, you know, maybe come back with thoughts instead of being asked to write on the spot about one sub-element versus the other sub-element. And I just want to, one other thing, because it just keeps trying to get pushed out, and that's the high capacity transit. And as Farhad said, it wasn't recommended in the long range regional transit plan, which I have been looking at. But it's really, again, about choices between frequency and 7-day and night service, more cost efficient. And what they do say, though, in their kind of their conclusion about the high capacity transit is that if community consensus builds around supporting significant redevelopment and densification in a specific area beyond downtown Tucson, then a high capacity solution like another streetcar could be a viable alternative. And so in that case, from what the PAG put together, the high capacity transit plan, whatever it was called, you know, talks about the same ones that the city has been talking about, but I will say the city brought us that project as one of their top priorities, or at least those two projects, whichever now the Oracle Road. So I would like to hear from the city of Tucson, based on the long range regional transit plan, if that's what they're planning on doing, like what Arlen had said has happened downtown. There's the Oracle and then there's the Stone. And many years ago, because of where I live, I was involved with the city in a Stone Avenue corridor project, and it talked just about that, with having more dense corridor and more businesses and residences on there. So, I mean, the city has said it's a priority. So I guess I would like to ask them, about these recommendations from the Long Range Regional Transit Plan. That's what they actually indeed do have in mind. So hopefully we can get that too.
Yeah, actually that sounds like something that we really do need to talk about. Let's try to get those two things, the other elements and this high capacity transit issue. By the way, we've moved into item 5 on our agenda. Future agenda items. Go ahead, Bruce.
Yeah, just to that point, I thought Mel Cohen came forward with a series of really thoughtful questions, and I don't know that we have addressed those yet. So I would hope that maybe at our next meeting we could try to touch upon those, because they provide answers that I'd like to hear. So.
Yeah, good point. There were two other issues at the end, items 4 and 5, I think, on his list, but they weren't. I felt that we needed to hold those back and do them, and this might be the right time to do it. Did I see another hand up with a? Was it?
I was just going to emphasize the high capacity transit issue is one that really needs to be dealt with. I totally agree with it. It is probably the most clear demonstration of the ability of building something and generating something and having it generate development and in the center part of the city. And be very clear on the city of Tucson. They have a study going on that north part of that route that is all about linking transit and their development. I don't know how far what I read, they're not at a point yet to decide between Stone or Oracle, but that's what they're working on. So I think it's very important
this is the that Norte, we discuss that. Norte Sur. Study, I guess.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks. All right. Thanks, everyone, for your participation. Appreciate it. And we'll meet again in 2 weeks, less 1 day. So Monday, the at 3 p.m. Thanks. We're adjourned.